Thank you. I don't really have too many instructions. For those of you who have been to NESSIS before, you know that we generally end the day with a panel discussion, and we've changed topics over the years and done different sports, basketball and baseball in the past. And this year's something new for us. We're going to do hockey. We've had several good presentations about hockey today. So I'm going to introduce the moderator for the panel, and then he'll take over and introduce the panelists. So the moderator for the panel is Michael Schuckers, and he's a professor of statistics at St. Lawrence University, and he's the co-founder of Statistics Sports Consulting. He's an applied statistician, has a PhD in statistics from Iowa State, and he's received funding for his work from the National Science Foundation, the United States Department of Defense, the United States Department of Homeland Security, the Center for Identification Technology Research, and a Major League Baseball team. He's a three-time finalist at the MIT Sloan Sports Analytics Conference Research Paper Competition, and he's been a Fulbright Scholar in Finland and a recipient of the ASA's Section on Statistics in Sports Significant Contributor Award. Michael Schuckers.
Thank you, Scott. Let's just thank Mark and Scott one more time for a great day. So it is indeed my great pleasure to be moderating this panel and not sitting on the panel, answering the questions. So let me introduce them to you. Immediately to my right, or nearest to me, is Brian Macdonald. Brian is entering his second season as the Florida Panthers, director of hockey analytics. He uses mathematics and statistics and data analysis to inform decision-making for scouts, coaches, the front office, sales, and marketing. Prior to joining the Panthers, he received a PhD in mathematics from Johns Hopkins and spent 6 years as an assistant and associate professor in the Department of Mathematical Sciences at West Point. On the far side, is Michael Peterson. Michael enters his seventh year as statistical analyst for the Tampa Bay Lightning. I should say that I think that is the longest for any publicly known sort of statistical analyst in hockey. He's responsible for assisting management and the coaching staff by providing analytical and statistical evaluations for hockey operations, contract valuation, as well as giving recommendations for the draft, free agency, trades, and other areas as needed. He also assists departments with specific statistical projects, including ticket sales, pricing, and revenue. In the middle of all of this is Andrew Thomas. Andrew's an associate professor of data science at the University of Florida. He earned his PhD in statistics in 2009 at Harvard, right upstairs, he wants you to know. His primary research interests are in Bayesian and big data computation, social network analysis, design of online experiments, and he's currently consulting for the Minnesota Wild of the NHL. So that is introduction to the panel. I'll make a couple of notes here to get started. And the first is, all of our panelists are from Florida, which seems a bit ironic given that we're talking about hockey in New England. The other thing I think that's worth noting is that they're all US. I mean, obviously, by being in Florida, they're all US-based. Though Andrew was originally Canadian, and I still Canadian, yes. So to get things started, we've seen a little bit of introductions. So describe for me how you each got the position that you have, and sort of your roles within the organization, and we'll start on the far side with Mike.
My role has somewhat evolved, I guess, over the years. So I kind of started out by doing various projects in Excel that they really had no one else to do. So I think there's different ways that people can sort of get involved with the team.
You want to go next, because you're the next longest?
I'll go next, I guess. So
I guess I originally, as Schuckers mentioned, I was working in the math department at West Point, and this gentleman by the name of Vinny Viola decided he was going to buy the Florida Panthers, and he happens to be a graduate of West Point, and had some people working for him that were West Point grads, and one of them had actually taught at West Point 1 year that I was there. I never met him, but we mutually both knew an assistant hockey coach at West Point, and so it was sort of a friend of a friend of a friend type thing is how I first got in touch with the organization.
So I've been in this role for a grand total of 8 days, so my story is going to differ a little bit differently. But two things are actually worth mentioning. First is that I wrote a couple of papers in grad school here on Bayesian analysis of hockey, and it turned out that one of the guys in the Wild front office somehow read it, and apparently that put me on his radar for a bit, which was kind of flattering. At the same time, after the big hiring boom where he got his job and a lot of the other people in the league got theirs, I started a website with my student Sam Ventura called waronice.com that many of you probably don't know. But basically, it's an application of using R and some of the same stuff we were already doing in the classroom with some of our other papers to put out statistical information. And apparently that helped. People started to use it quite a bit, and that was nice to be able to contribute in that way. In the end, I don't know if Minnesota would have cared one way or the other, but they were actually very supportive of the community effort that was going on, so that now that I've got this, we're handing that site off to a bunch of other people who are interested in doing the same thing. And seeing as Sam already got hired with the Penguins about 2 months ago, you may have heard that one too, we're kind of hoping to get the reputation as the major pipeline from the quants up to the big leagues, so we'll see if that takes.
So Andrew, you mentioned Sam's hiring. I think last summer, right, 2014 has been dubbed summer of analytics in hockey, where we saw this transition with a bunch of somewhat high profile people being hired by teams. Though I should note that most media accounts miss Brian's hiring, which tells you more about hockey media than anything else. So give me a sense of what is the current state of hockey statistics. I'm not going to use the A word. So what is hockey statistics? What is statistical analysis of hockey, and where are we?
You've been here the longest. What do you think?
I think we're still in kind of a phase of figuring things out. Where hockey itself doesn't have a lot of things tracked, so there's sort of a big need for new data and more data that can be analyzed. There's been a lot done with shots and Corsi and net shots and things like that, but I think we're getting to a point where we just need more data and more things tracked.
I'd say that's fair.
I also agree.
Yeah. There's a difference, though, between the public and the private perceptions. So I can't speak at all to what everyone else or any other teams are doing. But one of the most interesting things that I've seen, at least in the public sphere, is people going to the trouble of collecting their own data. Specifically, starting with, one of the other big names in this hiring, who's now happened twice, was Eric Tulski, who got picked up in a part-time role by the Carolina Hurricanes about a year ago and was just recently promoted to a full-time spot. And he was one who had actually done his own data collection on a large scale with a community of other people. He was looking largely at when people either carry or dump the puck into the offensive zone. Just keeping count of this over a large number of games for a few teams. And that was such a success that now everyone else is copying that in a great way. You have more people who are doing that on their own, who are getting together to collect data across the internet for their own teams, getting much more narrow definitions of what they want to get. So people are responding to that need for data in a very exciting way.
Yeah, and really crowdsourcing to get the data that you want, I mean, is the only way to go, because as of right now, we don't have the tracking data that the NBA has and other sports have, although that is apparently coming in the next year or two.
Three years.
So I guess, once we get the XY tracking data, we can make another leap forward, at least privately. I guess the public won't have access to that data, unfortunately, but that's when we'll be able to make another jump, kind of like the NBA has. I would agree that hockey hockey stats, hockey data analysis is still in its infancy, I would say, even though there was this big boom last summer that got a lot of attention. I would say we're nowhere near the peak of its use.
How much of that hiring boost do you think was PR related?
That's a great question.
I mean, especially for someone who might not have gotten that that reputation. It was pretty clear. I mean, from my perspective, when your hiring went through, it was very much they had an idea. They had a plan from a while back where they knew what they wanted to bring in from the outside, from like the hedge fund world. It was very clear.
Right.
That was,
yeah. Yeah, so to give you a little background, the two owners, their company in New York is a financial company. So they're not afraid of numbers, as one of them told me at one point. They're not afraid of numbers. So, you know, one of the things that they wanted to do when they bought the team was to do basically Moneyball for hockey. So
they said that verbatim, didn't they?
I believe so. Yeah. Or at least that's how it was translated to me. So I don't know if they said it verbatim, but
they probably did.
They might have said Money Puck. I don't know.
Just to fill in for the audience who isn't particularly know a lot about hockey, the events that are recorded by the NHL, hits, shots, missed shots, block shots, face-offs, penalties.
Goals, obviously.
Goals.
Giveaways, takeaways.
Giveaways, takeaways.
Giveaways and takeaways. So, yeah, there's a lot of questions.
A lot of quality.
Obviously, there's stoppages. And who is on the ice for those events? Did I miss? I think that's
the gist of it.
Pretty much
that's
it,
the gist.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Although, with again, varying levels of integrity in that data, not just within a game, but even with across leagues, buildings.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah. And we've noticed that there are different recording mechanisms, and so you have these rink effects because recording is slightly different in each rink. So given all that loss of talent, right, I guess it's a loss from my perspective as someone who's still working in the public sphere, right? Are we in a healthy place as a community?
I think so. But again, having a different perspective of this and not knowing the inside looks like as much. So there's this big thing probably the biggest profile hiring that made a difference in terms of like my personal life was when Daryl Metcalf, who ran a website called Extra Skater, he got hired by the Maple Leafs, but we didn't know it for about a week, during which time his website went down and it was like Wall Street had crashed. It was, everyone would think, what the heck's going on? And in particular, one of the fears was that the NHL had clamped down on him using their data without permission. We didn't have any info on this, but it was a fear that had gone around for a while, because I think the day before they changed the terms of service to say, you know this data we've got? You can't use it anymore. You can't take it and use it for yourself. Turned out to be more of a business, as far as I can tell, a business protection angle. But at the time, no one knew what the story was. So then as soon as his hiring got announced, pretty much everybody decided, you know what, if there is any actual risk of the NHL getting on board, we're going to trade that for the opportunity of getting a job. So within 2 weeks, you saw three or four different sites pop up with some of the same, different services, but some of the same stuff that had come up there before, with people who just dove in and got into it and established themselves that way. At least a couple of whom are in the room, I think, with people who are doing those. So then when CapGeek, who here knows what CapGeek is? So for those who don't, it was probably an even bigger impact than the stats side. It was all about salary databases. And the guy who ran that was a guy named Matthew Wiest. And it turns out he had cancer, and his site went down in January, and then word went out later that he was sick, and he died in March. When that announcement came out that was going on, about five or six giant sites jumped in to try and take the place of that one, getting all that data, because they knew what the importance was to the community. So from the perspective that I've seen, people realize that there are not only opportunities, but there is community, and enough people are out there to kind of support that along. So I think it's pretty strong going forward, even if some of us have disappeared.
So if it's strong, what are the elements that make it strong? What are the elements that make sort of a healthy ecosystem for statistical analysis of a sport?
I mean, I think, like Andrew mentioned, all the collaboration that goes on, as far as either the websites or the data collection, large groups of people doing the data collection, and, you know, they may not have, you know, they have varying backgrounds, but they all decide, they come to the conclusion that they need to really make this data collection rigorous. Like, you know, they might not have training, or maybe they weren't stats majors or something like that, but so they might not have formal training in that, but they've all decided, you know, they've taken measures to make sure that all this data is collected in some uniform manner as much as possible, with the sort of subjectivity of a lot of the data. It's not totally possible, but so there's a lot of collaboration there.
I think attribution is probably a big one too.
Attribution.
So I'll freely admit that I've stolen from these guys in the work I'm going to do. But specifically, one of the things that that had come up earlier was the differences between buildings. And at the very least, Schuckers, and I think you were involved in this as well, came up with some methods to kind of fix that, to say from both from the perspective of someone is getting a little too eager in counting the number of hits in a building. This happens in a few. Toronto, the Islanders, at least a few of those, get very eager to award a hit for whatever reason, compared to some of the stingier buildings. Another is that the locations on the ice are different. So New York, Madison Square Garden in particular, is very different. Your home building has got this weird effect where no one ever takes a shot within 5 feet of the net.
Push everything out.
This pushed force field out there. And for what we did, we said, well, look, these guys have already got a pretty good correction. We're going to build it in. We're going to share it out there. And I think we've given you adequate credit. If we haven't, we'll re-trumpet it out there. But we did it a little bit differently than you did, too. We did some adaptations according to the different method. We shared it out there. We pointed back to the resources. So the healthy, I tried to keep the healthiest bits of academia as alive as possible within that sharing. But given that there isn't as central a... There are journals, obviously, like what we're talking about here, but for the really fast reproduction and sharing of data, it's social media that tend to do a lot of that driving. So that's where it ends up being shared a little more directly.
And I like the fact that, at least in all the cases that I know of, sort of academic folks and folks that run blogs kind of get along fairly well. I've seen lots of discussions on the pros and cons of each of those. But I think there are pros and cons of each of those, and I just think that's what contributes to kind of a healthy community.
I think another thing that is required is for new ideas and people to come up with, you know, new ways to look at things, things that have been tried before. So Tulski was good at that. He developed a lot of new things, and you know, losing him to the public hurts, but there will be other people that will step in and come up with new things. And if there's, you know, new data being collected or new ideas for other things that should be collected. So.
Okay. We're getting along too well up here. We should be brawling.
Yeah. So stepping back a sec, what sports have the healthiest ecosystems?
That's a very good question. I can tell you what seems to have the least healthiest, and there's probably enough people in this room that would either agree or disagree, is basketball.
So for example, right, I know people who do lacrosse, and I don't think there's a critical mass of people doing lacrosse, right, that you would have a healthy ecosystem there, right? Sure. But, you know, what sports might, or list those that don't?
Let me actually ask, how many of you guys do basketball research? How many of you talk to each other? That was one of the big, like last year when that came out, that was one of the big fears, because it had happened in basketball where there was a big hiring wave and some of the sites had disappeared, some of the discussion had stopped. There was at least a couple of big think pieces about it, and that was one of the big fears that I know hockey's tried to adapt to. I don't know anything about football and what's going on there. Baseball has probably reached about a critical mass where its stuff is still happening publicly. I know that pitch FX analysis is one that's just kind of caught everywhere. But I also don't see a wide range of stuff. I only ever see the same sorts of topics being discussed. Like the presentation earlier today on catcher framing has been done by three or four different organizations. Baseball Prospectus had done their big one they published. Actually, they shared their code in R, which was pretty impressive. But I haven't seen a lot of variety compared to what the sorts of questions that are being asked compared to what I've seen in hockey.
Soccer?
I don't know it. Other in the room, other people in the room do. These guys do. How open is that?
We're good. Yeah.
You're good?
Yeah.
All right.
We're good.
How much of that relates to the fact that you're in North America and Europe as this one bigger community compared to, say, hockey, which is probably more focused?
I think a lot of, I think Mike Goodwin, who used to write for Grantland and covers the soccer scene, actually, he talks about how much better his information was when he was waking up in European time, because he misses about 5 or 6 hours of night of discussion when he wakes
up
in the US.
What else is big?
All right, so
I don't know what the fishing. I don't know the fishing analogy.
Yeah, no, I don't know fishing. Okay, so step back. Hockey as a sport, how healthy is it?
Can you ask this question 2 months ago, please?
Sorry.
As a sport, you mean as an evolving sport?
As an evolving sport in the marketplace of other sports.
I think it's at a good spot. Seems like it's been doing well the last few years.
Yeah, you almost got the cup.
I mean, it's, in terms of analytics, I think it's at least, you know, moving forward, moving in the right direction after, you know, maybe for a while it seemed like for years stuck. Other teams or other sports were kind of moving forward, and maybe hockey wasn't as much, but I think at least I think it's starting to move forward a little faster than a snail's pace.
I'll take that. So what about hockey analytics is different from other analytics? Right, I mean, I think hockey, I used the A word, sorry. Hockey, all right. Statistical analysis of hockey is, I think it's fairly a niche, certainly in the US, though it's a pretty passionate niche. So for folks who aren't involved in hockey, what makes hockey different?
And I guess one thing would be power plays and penalty kills. When you play a significant portion of the game, either up 5-4 or down 4-5, five players versus four players. I mean, not up 5-4 in the score.
Early these days.
So that presents its own challenge. It's almost like a new game when that happens, a new style of play. Somewhat new rules, no icing rules anymore for at least the team that's down a man. So that presents some sort of unique situations.
I think even to the point where people will often ignore those parts of it and just look at the rest of the game because it's a continuum. People will just look at 5-on-5. It is 80% of what you're looking at in the game, but it's still...
Not everything.
It's not everything. What are you going to do with the other 10, 20?
Yeah.
And that's definitely true. People's approaches have been very like just tacking it onto the end, saying, well, you're going to score 20% of the time in a power play, so let's just call it that. It's not quite going to do the level which you'd like.
Sure.
And I'm sure both of you guys, geez, it's obvious I'm going to pump for information, isn't it? I think that at some point the discussion becomes what happens when it is different. And when it becomes, actually, there's a perfectly valid point right there. What's different between 5-on-5 play and power play versus shorthanded is you're probably working with a little more of a plan if you have a power play coach. You have a strategy that's pretty well followed. You're gonna cycle, you're gonna drive, you're gonna block the net.
More structured.
Much more structured. Probably also much more coachable at that time. You can compare that part to something like football or baseball defensive alignment or a basketball coach calling a play on every one of those. The idea that hockey is much more freewheeling and looks spontaneous, I don't believe that's really true, but it's definitely the perception. That sure. Must affect a lot of how people will perceive it. And then the rules are a little bit different each place.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think, where do teams use plays? They use set plays off face-offs. They have set breakouts. So things like that are maybe a little more structured, and maybe those are things you can study in different ways. I mean, another thing that we have talked about in the past before we were no longer allowed to talk with each other was the idea of replacement letter, replacement level players. Like a lot of sports, you'll have wins above replacement level, WAR or whatever, and WAR on ice was. Did that influence the name at all?
Yeah, slightly.
But defining a replacement level player on the power play is kind of a tricky thing to do because, you know, typically a replacement level player is someone who can be freely acquired through waivers or free agency. That's what you typically think of in baseball or basketball or something like that. And I guess you'd think of that in hockey too, at least 5-on-5, but what does it really mean on the power play? Because less than half the league probably gets significant power play time, so it's a little tricky to define replacement level because of power plays and penalty kills.
Mm-hmm. So let me jump ahead because that was one of my later questions. So let's just stick to 5-on-5. How do you define replacement level in hockey?
Well, we've got our garbage definition that seems pretty good for us, which is take players who have less than this amount of time and take off their nameplates in the back and stick the word replacement on there. And then that gives you some measure of pooling between all the different players who wouldn't have gotten a lot of exposure. It also lets you correct if you're doing any kind of adjustment based on the other players on the ice, that these would be the replacements. I'm sure there's a good musical joke in there too. But anyway, the idea that comes down is that's at least it's a tactile definition that you can get your hands around, but it might not be legitimate in terms of what it really means in terms of a player you could acquire on the waiver wire, or one of those. So, question is, who cares? I mean, it comes down to exactly what task you're trying to do. Are you trying to measure them against the cheap guy you get on the waiver wire? Or is it just a convenient placeholder?
Yeah, I would say that the structure of the game is so different than, like, baseball. If we're talking about a replacement level player in baseball, it's someone who's going to bat every 9 batters. It's someone who's going to hold some position in the field. If we're talking about hockey, a replacement call-up guy could be a fourth line guy that we need to fill a role. It could be a sixth defenseman or something. It could be a top six forward. I mean, there's some players that if you put them in the bottom six, they're not effective at all. They need to play a top six role. So I think just the structure of the game makes the meaning of replacement level quite different than baseball, where that guy is going to get essentially an equal share of the playing time of everyone else that's in the batting order.
And just for audience members, somebody on the fourth line is maybe playing 6-7 minutes a night?
Yeah, maybe
versus a first or second who's going to be playing 20 minutes or so,
in the neighborhood.
Right, roughly.
Yep.
Yeah. So a couple of questions about the type of game. So is hockey a possession game? Andrew wrote a post a while back asking the question, and I don't know that it was answered, whether it was a positional game or a possession game. And I'm wondering your opinions.
I think the answer is yes. Yes, it is a position game. Yes, it is a possession game. One of the interesting things, that the answer to that may have changed. I think it was pretty clear then before lockout 2 in 2004, there was a strong emphasis on keeping it in the other zone, where the location of the puck was the most important factor. Whereas when speed started to become more of an issue, it was the idea that you control it, break out, carry through. I don't know what the actual answer to that is. I know it's both. But you're still, if an average team is facing an average team, you're still better off being closer to the other net than you are being to your own, but with the puck. But it's a very small advantage.
That was one of your early papers that you had done at Harvard also, right?
Yeah, right upstairs. Consider right applying. Upstairs. It's a wonderful place. Yeah, trying to break it into that exact element, it was, which is actually going to be better for you. And for the average team, it was, well, you're this close to the net, and the puck could go in, versus it has to come all the way back to the other side, even if the other guys have got possession of it. So just from a matter of what happens, you're going to get turnovers, or you're going to get transitions or breakouts. At some point, there's a question to be asked. As far as is it a possession game or not, I don't know. One of the things that I'm sure you guys would agree upon is the oversimplification of these measures of shot attempts, the most popular ones being the names Corsi and Fenwick. after real life people who toyed with this stuff, as opposed to something what baseball would come up with, but where possession would get acronymed into something like powerful opposition supposing. I don't need to get it. With the shorthand of the idea was, if you're shooting the puck, even if it's bad, then that's a shorthand for possession of the puck. But it's also a shorthand for you were in their zone in order to shoot it. So nomenclature-wise, it's definitely taken on. I have no real idea how well that connects to the elements that people will talk about in a possession game, like keeping it in your own end, cycling, doing the breakout, carrying it in, not giving up, or even simplest question I would have is, are you going to dump it in or are you going to retreat into your own zone? As just one aspect of that. I think every coach is going to give you a different answer. I think every coach 10 years ago, even the same ones, would give you different answers then. But that's why I'm going to legitimately say my answer is it a possession game or a location game? My answer is yes.
Yeah, one time, one reason it's kind of nobody has really shown that, at least recently, is because the NHL does not publish publicly possession data, possession time data, or zone time data. So you can't do what you can maybe do in other sports in terms of that. I'm sure that teams track it on their own, but it's not available publicly, so research in that area has not moved forward, at least in the public.
Yeah, I would just say that once the player tracking data becomes available, we'll have more information to be able to answer that question. Maybe basketball can answer that question for their sport right now. But
I think the answer there is also yes.
It probably is, yeah.
Okay, then that leads into my next question. I'm going to give you a variable, and you're going to give me over under on it. So years to the next NHL expansion.
Two and a half is year. Well, we have to give you a number, right? And we over or under?
Oh. Yeah.
Okay. I'm gonna call 2.5. What do you guys think?
I'll say under.
Under. Yeah. But
I who the heck knows what's actually going on with that? But I think we'll probably see a team, regrettably, in Vegas within a couple of years. Announced within a couple of years. Quebec City would be a fun one too. Everyone I know who lives in Seattle who likes hockey is desperate that it would end up there, but that's at least 4 years off, just given that they don't have a place to play this time.
How many teams in the Western Conference in 2017-18?
I'd prefer it at state 14, purely for selfish reasons. Oh, boy. Let's say 15. Let's say it goes 15-17 because it doesn't really matter. Well, it kind of matters, but.
Michael Lopez would disagree.
For those of you who don't know, that the NHL has an uneven split in the West and the East. So there's 16 teams in the East and 14 in the West. And there's only 8 playoff teams in each conference. Number of Massachusetts teams making the playoffs in 2015-16.
I can't.
Yeah. Well, all right.
Question.
We'll move on. All right. Next one. I'm going to give you the presidential candidate, and you're going to give me the NHL equivalent.
All right.
So Ted Cruz.
Ted Cruz. Let's see. John Tortorella. Likes to believes very strongly in what he does, even if he doesn't have the evidence to back it up. Has a stronger connection to Canada than he would like to admit. and we'll probably see unrealistic success compared to everywhere else if Torts is going to be coaching the U.S. World Cup team, and Ted Cruz might get some measure of success coming up. All right, good. I got an easy one out of the way.
All right. Jeb Bush.
I feel like I shouldn't answer this.
I also feel like I shouldn't answer this.
Hit the Florida one. I figure we can get one out of there.
All right. We'll do the Donald.
Okay, we already agreed on this one beforehand, so that helps.
The Calgary Flames.
Yeah.
And Brian Burke. And Brian Burke. I believe, yeah, let's.
The haircut is just too impressive to ignore.
How about Bernie Sanders?
Let's see. Where do we want to go with this?
NESSIS.
NESSIS is the
All right. I guess NESSIS can count as a hockey equivalent this year. Yeah. How about Hillary?
All right, where is she actually going to be from if we're going to tie it to that? If it's New York or one of those, let's see. On the rise, lots of money. Inevitable support being seen, but could collapse at any minute. I'm going to go with the Leafs.
Given that one of her home states is Pennsylvania, you wouldn't go with the Penguins?
Penguins are a good candidate for that, too. Overwhelming support, possible to fail, but I don't want to jinx Sam for the sake of this one yet.
Lots of baggage. Mike Huckabee, last one.
What do we got? What are our characteristics here? Let's see. Also,
I still feel like I shouldn't answer. So.
We'll change back a little bit here. You can wave a magic wand and change one thing about the NHL. What do you change?
Take out shootouts.
Really?
Yep.
Aw.
Let's bring ties back.
I'm the old. Yeah, I don't think I'd mind ties either, but I don't mind the shootout.
How many fewer shootouts do you think there'll be this year because of 3-on-3? Yep. Over under. We'll go back to the over under.
No, please.
I think I want my answer to be wider ice, but I might also want it to be shorter rink, because there's all this talk compared to like European style. Yeah. They talk about how it's all free and skating is a big factor, but from everything I've heard, it doesn't really increase scoring at all. And I think if I get to take my magic wand and say go back in time 30 years to when goaltending equipment was small and players were smaller a bit too, I'd like to see hockey scores look more like lacrosse scores. I don't know if I'm the only one who thinks that, but I like score. I like scoring. It's fun. It's interesting. It means that it's a better competitive advantage that you can be down three and come back than in a more modern game.
Yeah. You wouldn't mind 12-8 games?
No. I might mind a little too much showboating that would come out of a 12-8 game, but it'd still be more interesting.
I don't know if I would want that high scoring of games.
Maybe,
but I would like to see a little bit of an increase in scoring. Right. We need larger samples, right? So,
let's sneak it.
Not to be selfish.
One of the things. I've always been a fan of increasing the size of the. If you're going to increase goalie pads, increase the size of the goal by a little bit, not huge amount, like an inch on each side or something.
So that would really take a magic wand, because they take. Ever since these new rinks have come in, they built the plumbing so that you can't move the posts. I don't understand it, but somehow that's factoring in, because there's these little pegs that you stick into the ground. I don't know what's going on, but you could raise the top bar up a little bit. So if it's the height of the goaltenders are going up, I think isn't there an actual number on this that the average goaltender in pro hockey is like 4 inches taller now than they were 20 years ago?
Yeah.
So raise the bar 4 inches and you're closer to getting that back in terms of that scoring.
Yeah. Another one that wouldn't involve rebuilding the rink would be for delayed penalties. So in hockey, if one team gets a penalty and the other team has the puck, they can hold on to the puck and just continue play until the offending team gets possession of the puck. But in reality, it's not usually possession of the puck. The whistle can be blown if someone kind of just tips the puck with their stick, and I don't.
That varies, official to official.
Yeah, so that varies. So it's subjective. So that's one thing, and a lot of times it's not truly possession, and they're pinned in the corner, but they touch the puck, and they haven't really cleared the puck. So I would like to see them. If you're in your defensive zone, you have to clear the puck across the blue line, because then it's like you've actually gotten out of trouble, first of all, and then second of all, it's more objective. It's less subjective. Yep. So you're either across the blue line or not. I mean, it's a little bit subjective, but.
It would make it more exciting, too, because you'd have guys trying to clear it, and the other team gets to keep it in, like, on a power play, play continues.
Yeah. Yeah, so that would increase scoring also. So,
Scott?
So I had a question. And I'll premise this by saying I'm certainly not a hockey expert. The foundation for a statistical inference is randomization. And I was wondering, if you're trying to decide between two strategies, whether this is choosing between lines to play on a penalty kill or choosing between two goalies to play in net, Could you ever envision sort of mini experiments using randomization that would eventually inform future decisions? And obviously, we know this in medicine, certainly, that randomization is the most efficient way and most unbiased way to come to conclusions when you're trying to make decisions between strategies. Could you ever envision a scenario where such many experiments could be done in the course of hockey? And would there ever be any receptiveness to such a strategy?
I think convincing your team to do that during games would be tough, unless they're blowout games or unless you've already missed the playoffs or something like that. But I think there's a lot of changing. There's a lot of different line combinations that go out on the ice throughout a game and throughout a season. So you're not truly randomizing, but there's so many different combinations, and except in certain cases where certain guys play together 90% of the time. That happens on a couple teams like Vancouver and Anaheim. But I think most of the rest of the time, it's pretty well mixed. I don't know. Do you guys agree with that?
Yeah, I don't think you could convince your coach or someone to specifically try these random trials and see what happens. But there's probably certain situations that are already happening that we already have the data for that essentially emulates a randomization.
Yeah. So, do I get to play God for this question, or are we talking practically? Because one of the actual questions that we try to do, in at least all the work we've done, is trying to figure out which players are the best. And so that confounding approach is part of it, getting around that. And if you tried to say, let's just mix up the teams and play at a big tournament to beginning to see which players were the best, no owner would ever go for it, let alone the fact that there was injury risk, but there's no real profit in that. And neither is a tournament like the World Cup going to be like that, because you've got that same connection. But I do think I could see if you had someone who was willing to invest in it, if you're looking at like rule changes or trying to tune the game to just the right way, I could envision some kind of a tournament like that, maybe at the college level or at the low pro, where you had a large collection of people who volunteered to come and play a tournament, mix it up like this, make a few design rule changes in a very specific experimental way, round robin, Latin square type design. You could do something like that just to evaluate what those changes would be like. And so if you were trying to experiment with that in order to get a game, in order to make a change to the game that you thought was going to be more exciting, I mean, I'd be on board with that in a heartbeat. And at that level, if you're using other talent, you're not interfering with any of those other problems that a coach would, or that management would ever kind of object to. I think people might complain that it wasn't quite the real thing and it would need further study later on. But that kind of randomization design across sites, across teams, after maybe a little bit of you practice one day and then play later in the day just so you feel each other out. I could definitely see something like that happening.
I could also definitely see it happening on sort of the business side of the organization. So sales and marketing, kind of already talked about designing some randomized experiments sort of. So you can have a little more control, and maybe there's a little bit more leeway on those types of things. But as far as doing it in game, I don't know. I don't see that happening.
No, I think you'd have a hard sell with coaches. Can I stick to coaching decisions? Tell me about pulling the goalie. And I know we've seen a slight uptick recently. Why don't we see it more?
It's just such a big risk. It's not the same as I think some people try to equate it to football not going for it on fourth down. Well, if you're at the 30-yard line, even if you're on your own 20 in football and you go for it on fourth down and miss, okay, the other team still has to score, right? But in hockey, if you pull your goalie, it's not a mistake until the other team has scored in your net, and essentially the game's over. So rarely teams come back when they've given up an empty net goal. So it's just that the penalty for doing it is so large that it's difficult to, take that risk, right? Because you could still score, right? You're still playing at, you still have more minutes in the game where you're not pulling the goalie, and you could still potentially score during that time. So it's a decision, right?
Yeah, part of it, I think, is 1 minute is a nice round number to pull your goalie. I mean, if you're down one, or you know, if you're down one goal, pull the goalie at 1 minute. If you're down two goals, pull the goalie at 2 minutes.
Case
I think
close,
psychologically, but, it's sort of, I don't know.
I'm looking right at Lopez because I know he's got the numbers on this. what's the change been this season as opposed to last?
There's been a lot more with two goals down.
Okay. Who, by the way, did that? Patrick Waugh decided he was going to pull his goalie down one goal between 2 and 2.5 minutes, purely on gut feeling. But maybe also because, as a goaltender himself, he didn't want to be blamed. I don't know if that's actually true or not. I have a theory that is completely unsubstantiated relating to that. Is even if they did know the numbers mathematically according to a Poisson type model, which says at this point, the execution is still untested. Particularly if you've got one group of guys you're going to send out at the end of the game who are going to throw everything they've got at it.
They're going to play for 6 minutes straight.
Yeah, that's what we're going to do. We're going to send them out the whole time. We're going to break them down. But yeah, so a change like that would mean you'd have, if you're going to go to 3 minutes, or which is what I think most of us would agree based on the raw numbers is about the right point for a single deficit, you'd have to figure out how to get a second line, a second special team unit. And nobody has really thought of it that way. So why take any unnecessary risks that way?
I would say that's not true, that nobody's thought
okay,
of it.
Okay, Mr. St. Lawrence.
Yeah, so St. Lawrence women's hockey team regularly pulls their goalie with 6 or 8 minutes to go.
Is that based on analytics?
It might now be. I think they've continued it. I think it was originally based upon some intuition. I mean, I think the idea is that, you know, you're losing, right? And so you want to do everything, whether you lose by one goal or three goals, you're losing. You're getting no points. So
what do they do? Do they have two units for?
Well, they practice it, right? And so it's a much more seamless thing. Do they change
while it's in the offensive zone?
Yeah. Yep. They will change a couple of players at a time. It will often during prolonged times, it will come out and they'll change when it comes out.
I mean, they'll retreat and they'll change on the fly and then go back in?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think they would argue that it does, and probably at close to the rates that we would expect it to. Now, you know, it's less in the college game because you're playing about 30 games a year rather than 82. But I think, in particular in St. Lawrence's case, we're often fighting for home ice in the first round of our league playoffs, so somewhere between fourth and fifth. And those couple of points is a big deal, whether you're home or away for that three-game series. So, yeah, I mean, I think the coach there would say it's probably about a point a year, which is often the difference between that spot.
You mean just more opportunities to practice these things, test them out?
Yeah, so just, you know, even if it's 10 minutes, you know, twice a week or whatever, that's way more than you're ever going to get a chance to see in the game. Yeah.
I mean, that's one of the reasons why I'm thinking it's the college level where these things start to get done. I remember hearing this story about Bill Belichick having some discreet contact with a few, it was either high school or college coaches around the country, and he'd privately share these ideas with them, and he'd set it up like an experiment. These guys are going to try this style of offense this game. And of course they're going to trust Bill Belichick. Why would he lie? So you actually had that level of investigation being done off the clock, which was a great idea if it's true, and I'm willing to believe it either way. So just that you are getting that opportunity.
Yeah.
Is there still the empty net lab on the site?
Should be. Have a look. Open it up. Internet. I don't have my computer right here. So on warrenice.com under labs, there's a thing that pull the goalie, which just says you've got a Poisson type model for when the, for how the teams are going to score at 5-on-5, at 6-on, and at 6-on-5 for both sides. And all it does is it simulates the thing 10,000 times and says, that's the point at which you should have pulled the goalie under this. And that's the one that pulls 3 minutes. That's, of course, very simplified. It's not going to take into account, one of the reasons why I was curious why it would take off after the second lockout was because they changed the icing rule, that you can't substitute play. If you ice the puck and play is whistled, it comes back to your zone, you may not change your players. So if you have that as a result of an empty net situation, you could change it. The offensive players keep them fresh and then just lean on them until they break. And if you've got a longer period like that, mm-hmm. why wouldn't you go for it at that point? Maybe they are. Maybe that's exactly what they're doing. But if that assumption you can't build into the model as well, that's not fair. You can probably build in a fatigue assumption to a model, but I have no idea what it would be.
Is there an exception? I'll just say, let's actually, if we can open it up for questions, it'll be better to put it through the microphone, because then we can have it recorded for posterity.
Cool. Gentleman in the orange? I think the gentleman in the orange was speaking. Yeah.
Minor point. Isn't there an exception if you've pulled your goalie and you're attacking with six and the attacking team accidentally ices the puck? The puck goes back in their zone. Can't they put their goalie back in?
They can put their goalie back in whenever they like, can't they?
After they've been called for icing,
yeah.
They've already pulled their goalie.
Yeah.
They can't go. I don't think they can go back six in the defensive zone and defend without a goaltender. I think they're allowed to put their goaltender back on the ice.
Correct.
That's true. Yeah.
So minor exception.
Yeah. He's talking.
I'm
about
thinking the opposite case. So you have the six. The six is attacking the five. The five ices the puck.
The
six is icing the puck, it would have been from their defensive zone.
Right.
Yeah, and that's a weirder case, but yeah, that's
very
definitely an exception. Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Absolutely.
You mentioned the difficulty in trying to model fatigue. Have you been able to model fatigue at all? And can you mention that? I don't know if
I honestly haven't tried.
Are you attempting to?
I look at the problem and I say I can't unconfound this, which is not really true, but I don't have. I've never been brave enough to try it.
Brian, would you like to answer this?
No.
Is that in the public domain, Brian?
I don't think it would. I'm not sure if it was a public domain, but I did it before joining the Panthers, so I'll talk about it.
Thank you.
there's, you know, I guess in other sports you would call it like a expected goal model, where you estimate the probability that a shot will be a goal based on its location, whether it was a wrist shot, a slap shot, and things like that. One of the variables that I included at one point in one of the models was how long had that player been out on the ice on his shift, and the longer he had been out on the ice, the less likely that goal was, the less likely that shot was to go in. So that's the only time I've ever even looked at fatigue. I think I also did it for the five offensive players and the five defensive players. I was more interested in defensive players, seeing if the defense were more fatigued, would they be able to contest the shot, less? And I believe the effect was very, very small, if anything, with that one, which I thought was a little surprising.
So. I'm curious if, what you going back to that sort of wave your magic wand, what do you guys think of the whole point system, and what benefits does it confer versus, I don't know, other sports that have 82 games and just use things like winning percentage? And if you think about football, they have ties and they don't go by a silly point system.
Yeah, so in hockey, it incentivizes teams to play for a tie, essentially, because you get 1 point for getting the tie at the end of regulation, then you got whatever percentage chance of winning the shootout. So then that game becomes worth 3 points instead of a game that ended in regulation being worth 2 points. So that's one reason why I said to eliminate the shootout, because then you have every game worth 2 points. You have ties, you just give each team a point, go back to the old system.
Didn't someone in this room call it the stupidest invention in all of professional sports? I think, yeah.
So is that a good thing, that it incentivizes that?
I think it's terrible. I think anything that sniffs of collusion couldn't possibly be a good invention, even if it's not true collusion. But again, I'm going to point to Lopez, because I know he's done the actual math on this publicly, showing that two teams in the same conference will not, maybe not show that behavior, but definitely two teams in different conferences will just not push as hard and divvy up more points that way. I can't imagine that it measures up to the basic definition of sportsmanship if you're trying desperately to win, or even if it, you know, if you're not trying to get hurt or something, maybe I can understand, but not in this case. I think it's nuts.
So what's your alternative?
I like a lot of the other systems. I like 3-2-1-0. 3 points to a regulation win, two for an overtime win, or even a shootout win.
Sure.
If a game has to end in a win or a loss. I personally like the idea of making it instead of that, but 2-1.5-0. But people seem to be allergic to fractions in that way. I think one of the weirdest objections, it's an understandable one, but the idea that you can't compare historically one team to another across 30 years if the point system changes, so that's why we're not going to make it 3 points. So that's why I thought, well, we'll just make it the 2-1.5, because that at least keeps the numbers in the same scale. The good team's always going to get that far. I don't know how much of an actual business interest there is to compare last year's Chicago Blackhawks to the 1967 Leafs, in terms of whatever that is, when we had six teams as against compared to 30. That's already going to be a big scale change as it is. Someone thinks there's value in that, and I can respect people believing there's tradition, but this point rule is only, the extra point rule is what, only 15 years old? It's a mere teenager. I think we can get rid of it without worrying about tradition too much.
How far down into your minor league affiliated teams does statistical analysis go, and like, does it filter back up to the major league team?
I have absolutely no idea.
I think it definitely goes to the AHL level. For us, we don't currently have a... So AHL would be kind of like AAA for baseball fans out there. AA might be ECHL. We don't currently have an affiliation, so you can talk about that. But I think definitely to the AHL, there's advanced statistics being used, for sure.
Even if the data's crap.
So we have problems with having enough data in the NHL level. The AHL level is below that, so.
Considerably.
Yeah.
Yeah, and at the U.S. college level, I think the data is even below what you've got. So I haven't looked at ECHL data, but certainly it's below what you have at AHL. And big rink effects, I'm sure, exist in those data.
I know that that Toronto has spoken about using the ECHL more as a development league, and given their massive amounts of money and firepower, I'm guessing that they've got something going on there, but I have no idea what it would be. It helps that they at least also have their minor league team in the same city, and their ECHL team is 2 hours away from me in Florida, in Orlando. The Solar Bears definitely have the coolest possible jerseys. I don't know if they have the coolest possible numbers guys, but I wouldn't doubt it given what they've got.
Following up on the questions about sort of being experimental and how experimental to be and how challenging it can be, where do you think hockey should be on the continuum with the other sort of major sports, particularly in North America? For instance, I think you can make the argument that college basketball coaches should maybe devalue the regular season and be more experimental because over time the sports gravitated more and more to March Madness, whereas that's less true, I think, in the NBA. I'm curious where you think hockey compares to those and the other kind of major sports.
How would you want to do it? I mean, I can see an argument about using the minor league system more for that rather than the regular, you know, the actual in-season time. I personally don't want to piss off a single coach in the organization because I know that I would like to be listened to at some point. And making those kinds of suggestions might seem a little too, at this stage, I'd call it premature. But I can definitely see there'd be a balance at some other level where that sort of experimental philosophy would come into it.
I mean, I think playoff seeding maybe matters less
in hockey than it does in other sports. And maybe that's what you're getting at since you use college basketball as an example, but which, you know, I think seeding probably matters less in a single elimination tournament than it does, maybe, I don't know, I'm just guessing, than it does in like a best of seven series. But and I think home ice advantage matters less than like home court advantage in basketball and things like that. I've never actually looked at it, but that's just kind of a guess. So maybe you think if seeding doesn't matter a whole lot, why not do more random experiments? I think you want to maximize the number of home games that you get also, though, from a business perspective.
Yeah.
And since I do both hockey and business analytics, that I'll put on my other hat for a second and say probably want to maximize the number of home games.
In terms of how you function professionally, not in terms of what stats necessarily, but how much information do you use that's public already, and how much influence do you really have with managers, coaches, players, scouts, etc.?
I shook the coach's hand for the first time last week. He's got a great grip. So far, I mean, I'm only starting in this, and I'm still working through all the data that I've already assembled through our own enterprises. So I'm curious to see what everyone's got prepared for there. I'm sure you'd love to disclose all of your wonderful pieces of information.
I think I do more work for people like front office and scouts than I do for coaches. In my opinion, that stuff at this point, given what is available to us, that stuff has a little bit more value than the stuff that we can do for coaches. So I've definitely focused more on that kind of thing.
I would say that we use public information and our own information in-house. I would say that I provide my input across the organization. Now it's up to them as to what level they use that at.
You're not pounding your fist in there saying, we gotta get this guy.
Certainly teams have scouting data that's not public, right? That is heavily used.
Sure.
Right, I think that would be maybe the one big area where there's the largest gap between what's publicly available and what's privately available.
That's the stuff that most organizations will protect with their firstborn.
Yeah.
It's definitely, that doesn't make sense. You know what I mean? It's very valuable, they wouldn't want to give it up. And they probably overvalue it too, because they think they have a little confidence in what their people have done for a bit of time.
Yeah.
But I'm sure there's still value in it.
Sure.
Yeah. I almost feel like, my role is kind of like a full-time consultant, sort of, because like Mike said, you know, he provides his opinion or his I don't want to say opinion. He provides what he thinks the data says.
Sure. Professional judgment.
Professional judgment. And then, you know, they make their job. It's not our job to make the decision. It's their job to make the decision based on the information that they get from us and other people in the organization. So
yeah.
I kind of feel like in almost every part, in every part of the organization where I play a role, I kind of feel like I'm sort of like a full-time consultant in different areas of the organization. I don't know.
Which teams would you say are doing the best in this area? If you had to name a couple of them. It's relatively infancy, this whole hockey statistics, analytics, especially compared to some of the other sports. Is there a team or two that are really at the forefront and you're kind of jealous of the resources, money, personnel that they've got
in
their organization?
I can say one thing, that Toronto is obviously a name that's been attached to a lot of this, particularly with all the people they've been bringing in. I don't know I barely know any of the work they've actually, the people who have been involved and been hired, I don't know what they've actually done aside from the extra skater or the drafting record with the Sault Ste. Marie Greyhounds and the way they promoted their team. But for example, at the draft, so going back to the Belichick example, legitimately, one of the things that he was known for was trading down draft picks because of the overvaluing of higher ones and building up a bigger draft pool. Now, this is my first draft back in June, Florida, where we hung out for at least a little bit. And these guys were busy, they had jobs. But it was very clear Toronto was doing that. They were trading down to get more depth from that. And I thought it was pretty clear that was something that those guys had said. There's some value in the draft that they're clearly monetizing. And there, those moves were much more obvious. Beyond that, I don't know what they're actually doing. They were also paying for biometric data. This was a news article about a week ago that seemed like, okay, that's interesting, but who knows how they're actually going to use it. If they've got the pockets to go into it and are finally willing to spend, that would suggest that they've got a pretty legitimate presence with that. Beyond that, there's not a lot we can tell about what other people are doing, aside from the more public feints and everything that's going there. But I'd say they're legitimately trying something. And it's not just because I grew up with them and would like them to do well. Right now, I don't want them to do well. But they seem to be much more, they're doing things that are publicly recognizable. There's the other one. They've been signing a bunch of players who everyone assumes they're going to trade for draft picks because they're not going to make the playoffs. So they're making moves that are very clearly resource conscious without being limited by funding. They're trying to spend the money to get hockey resources in a way that a lot of people will see and believe that's that they think that's the exact strategy they're trying to do.
And just to add, many of those signings are folks that are highly thought of by the analytics community to be valued above what the hockey market generally thinks of them. But I mean, I think that's also true for some of the moves that Chicago's been doing for a while.
I don't think I would have given 10-5 each to each of those star players, but that's a one-time thing.
Right, but I think some of their other moves going back 4 or 5 years suggest that, and there's some other anecdotal data there.
If you can sign a second line guy to play in your fourth line, that looks pretty good too.
Yeah.
But you guys have also had quite a bit of efficiency coming in through. Let me take a stab at this, because by no means official, I have no inside information, but the way that you guys have used your farm system has been lauded very successfully, that you've used development at a very good level like that, mm-hmm. without rushing or going to any of that level. I don't know if there's any numbers involved or if that's entirely philosophy based on the people in your organization who are extremely smart, some of the best that I've ever seen.
Yeah, I would say it's mostly philosophy.
Yeah. And rather than
how they want to handle it. Yeah.
But value seems to be one of those. If someone was going after that, they'd probably not want to oversign an expensive player.
You have to be able to be patient too, and not, you have to be willing to kind of accept where you're at in a season and not just rush your players up before they're ready. So it's not every organization can do it, I don't think.
So admittedly, I'm a relatively new bandwagon hockey fan, but one of the things that I've had to consciously deal with is that there's just a lot of inherent uncertainty in the game. Sometime you'll dump it in and a percentage of the time you'll get it, and then sometimes you'll get a shot out of it. If you guys were to think maybe like 5 years, 10 years down the line where you have a lot more of the data you've been describing, how limiting is it going to be just, the inherent uncertainty to the game, and how do you think about analyzing that?
That's a great question.
Yeah.
I'm thinking.
Yeah, I haven't thought of that question. Yeah.
I think there's obviously those kinds of limits, and the more data we think we're going to get are going to be outcomes of there's essentially going to be a lot of noise, like a lot of noise coming into it that people will and the media are going to overinterpret. It's everybody's job to figure out where the hell the signal's coming from there and how much of an improvement you're going to get on that. I think I see the limit as being, if it's Poisson-like and your mean is you're only going to get 2.5 goals a game, give or take, how much more could you really build on that? I don't know. I'm curious to know what you could build on top of that. But just with that individual limit going on right there, that's challenging. And so it becomes more an issue of... I think of more of like a resource allocation thing. Where can you find the things that are going to be less noisy to build on? Because you're not going to get too many opportunities. It's bland enough to just be complete without giving anything away. But there's not much more, I think, unless you guys have got the secret recipe or withholding it.
One of the ongoing frustrations for quite a while is the quality of hockey data. Many of the leagues have put money into sort of fixing this problem. It's kind of an open question. Like, why hasn't it happened here? Are we trapped in a spot where we can't improve it before we get the tracking data, which, is sort of perpetually down the road? And did some teams go about their own ways of, you can't, maybe you can't say, I don't know, of fixing this issue themselves?
They must be. At least a couple of teams out there must be collecting their own. But as far as the league-wide problem?
Yeah, there's definitely teams who are collecting data that's already tracked by the NHL, but they think that the data isn't being collected in the way that they would like to see it collected, so they're doing it themselves.
I mean, if someone wants to go back and recount the hits over the league and pay their own money to do that, they're welcome to. But I don't think they're going to get much of an improvement there in terms of actionable data compared to some of these kinds of corrections.
Wait, hits aren't the most valuable statistic?
Well, they generate the most noise.
One specific example that I remember hearing about was for face-offs, teams tracking their own face-offs, just because, I mean, the NHL might have one definition of what it means to win a face-off, but you might have a different definition based on where the face-off's being taken and on the ice and things like that. So you may want to track face-off percentage by yourself because you have that different definition.
Yeah, and I certainly know of teams doing that.
You think it helps?
I mean, I think one of the questions about if hockey is a possession game is that face-off don't seem to matter a whole lot. But that's an assumption based upon using NHL data. But my guess is 5% of a difference there isn't going to change much of the value.
So someone once said, I say this like it's legend really, was something I read on Twitter 2 weeks ago, that at its root, hockey is about battling for the puck in a lot of different places. If you're, against the boards, if you're in open ice, and the faceoff is one part of that. It's also the one part that a coach can control because he gets to decide who's going to go in for it. So it makes sense that people would want to be able to approach that part of it. But I can definitely see if people are going to be collecting data to that level, that the puck battle is something people are going to focus on that's not currently being collected right now. I think it's going to be something the tracking data is going to pick up. It's definitely something that that a coach is going to track. Again, no knowledge whether it's who is actively doing it, including within my organization. But it's one that I know is it's valued for that reason, is that it's some part of it you think you can decompose that isn't currently being taken into account.
Is GPS data legal on ice?
Legal or?
In FIFA, it hasn't been legal up until this past year, where they sort of took a ban off of it. I was curious if you guys have that.
You can't wear a chip. I know that.
It's a PA.
Correct.
That would have to be. A PA.
I believe you can wear a chip in practice.
But that, I think, has to be agreed to.
Yeah, I'm not sure exactly of the laws there or whatever. But I think, as far as when the XY data comes to the NHL, I've heard, I think we've all heard, that the system that they'll use will be different from the NBA, where they're just using cameras or whatever. In the NHL, they're going to use a chip in the player's equipment and in the puck, basically because that's the only way you can track the puck. You can't track it with a camera. And probably also because of all the collisions, it's difficult to track players with a camera.
So it's funny, I heard almost exactly the opposite story from one of my people I've been talking to. Not with anyone who's connected to anything, but formally. But the idea was, you all remember the glowing puck from Fox? So that was the Sport Vision was the company who did that. It was back in 95, 96. And basically, it's technology inside the regular puck. They try to build it to be as much like a normal game puck as possible. And the thing costs $500 a pop. How many pucks get lost in the stands every game? We're talking maybe 10, 15 at minimum. How many people want to be the face of, we lost our big expensive puck? It's been a factor that when they've been discussing that, at least people I've talked to, is even that number scares them because it's this investment that spread over the whole league wouldn't be worth the return they were going to get on that. So if it were possible, I know at least a couple of people want to be able to do it optically. I think it's possible. I think it's possible to get 80 to 85% of what you want, but maybe you're going to lose it in the scrum or something like that. That's good enough for me because everything I want to do with that tracking is probably, acceptable level of noise as it is. That's not going to be good enough for TV, where you want active tracking of the puck at all times, just like with the Fox puck. So someone's going to have to compromise on what that's going to be, and I don't know who's going to pony up to make that happen if they want to pay 500 a unit for each of these things.
I would just add, I've had some conversations with some of these companies, and I think that price is high.
Oh, I'm sure they're padding it.
Yeah. No, I mean, I think that you're probably getting, but it still ends up being expensive, more like a $50 puck, with the possibility of some economies of scale bringing that down further. If you think about it being used in other leagues and in high schools and those sorts of things, which would be possible down the road. Yeah.
So in the current point system for individual players, a goal and an assist are both 1 point. Do you think that they should be weighted equally? And is the point system even like a good measure of player performance?
You mean how loud the crowd yells isn't good enough for you?
I mean, I guess if you were going to come up with the optimal weights, goals would be weighted a little bit more. But I'm okay with the point system. I think it's good enough for players.
For players,
sorry, not for games.
No, yeah. I don't know. It's probably going to be descending one way or the other, from goals down to second assists. But isn't there also a difference in what someone will call an assist? So there's maybe. I'm not a basketball fan at all, but there's a very precise definition of what's an assist in basketball, right? It's like it has to be.
There's a poster on that.
Which I, of course, read. Yes. But, I mean, even there, it's a much more well-defined system that at least has some predictive validity. I don't know if... I'm pretty sure that primary assists do. I mean, we've been asked about this with Liz, but particular... People love the idea of being able to split into goals, primary assists, secondary assists. And at least some people that I've looked at think that the secondary assists are not out-and-out worthless, but not providing as much information as if they were on the ice entirely. So if I had to just start, scrap the whole thing and start over, it would be easier to do primary goals and primary assists being one and secondaries being zero, but people would throw a fit if that ever happened publicly because comparability across eras. I'm fine with, as it exists, I'm fine with it, but we also have the option to be able to split it however we like. We're not limited to that. And as far as award, like if it matters about, it only really matters in terms of awards. If someone's going to get an award because they got more second assists than they otherwise would have got.
It can affect arbitration too.
Yeah. It's going to directly affect money in a lot of different ways. And so if I was going to propose that, a few people would probably object to changing it at all just because it had been like that for so long.
Right.
All right, so in the past year or so, NHL.com and ESPN have been pushing hockey analytics a little bit more. NHL released all their data on their site. How important do you think it is to have those bigger media companies engaging with the public in terms of hockey analytics?
Can I answer fairly on this one? Because, I mean, they're not a direct... I've had conversations with these guys about what they want to provide. And the goals are a little bit different because they're trying to advertise to this level of customer. And so far, it's always been these boutique operations. They, at least with what we've put out on our own services, it's been what people have asked for. So we've been able to respond a little more quickly to say, oh, you want second assists split out. You want to get more information on the XY data. Because we know we can respond to that quickly enough, we can serve our niche market quite well. And I say this as if we were making any kind of money whatsoever, because we're really not. When we're talking about a larger scale investment in it, I think the goals are definitely different. You're looking for example, if we're ever getting tracking data in there, you know that ESPN is gonna show the top speed of a skater during a game, because that's something that's tactile, that people will get into, that they can extract from that. It might show you the worst player on the team panicking to get back because they let a breakaway happen. So it might not be as predictive from the sense of what a team is going to care about. But there's a market for that too. The big organizations are going to, in some ways, kind of set the agenda for what's going to happen in the next, I want to say like the next 5 to 10 years, because that's definitely how the tech cycle has been working with that. It's important to establish for a larger scale business, but from what we're seeing, at least locally, having this quick response angle of it is just as important for the people who we know who are doing research as opposed to who are just watching, I'd say. What do you think? Do you get a cut? Do you get a cut of an ESPN TV deal? I don't know if you're interested. Sure. Whenever that happens. Well, the ESPN World Cup, for example, that's coming in.
Right? Oh, that's true.
Yeah. Rogers, any of these teams, any of these big organizations.
I don't know if we get any revenue share from that.
Yeah.
No, from the World Cup of Hockey, I imagine not.
Probably not. Yeah. I mean, that's the other answer, is how much of the team's going to benefit from that directly, why it would matter. There's so many different players in that to get into it. I think it's better that the NHL is listening to people who are doing more cutting-edge things, because they know they can get their labor cheap, because people will do this for fun. And the people that I've talked to, at least at the league office, some recognize that, and they know that, like, this is what people were going to want to do eventually. But it's really hard if you're going to lay out for a five-year investment or something like that to predict what you should be doing. And that's actually one reason why, I'm going to say this as carefully as I can to make sure I'm not slinging mud on the league. The features that the NHL selected for their most recent rollout are very limited compared to what's been available for a few years. That's not because they don't want to put the good stuff out there. It's because they want to put the stuff out there that's been very thoroughly vetted, and they know people will have a wide appetite for, as opposed to some of the more experimental stuff, especially if someone gets it into their heads that it could be used in arbitration or free, or maybe not but definitely free agent signings.
Yes.
If they're upset about any of those possibilities, they want to make sure it's a solid idea first. So what we're seeing now with this new rollout is reflecting that. And particularly the one I'm most excited about is this historical data rollout, where they're going to go over the game sheets from the last 100 years, put all that stuff up there. It's a big crowdsourceable task that I think they could actually get a good draw out if they just released the raw documents. They're probably not going to do that because for the same reason, you want to have a good standard about how all these things are getting done. That's going to drive a lot of interesting action that's different from everything else that we're going to see, but it's still a part that's well vetted through history that people would want this, and it's less of a risk putting it up there than compared to everything else. All right.
Yeah, let's thank our panelists.